Dear Lord in heaven, we thank you for another day of life, for waking us up and giving us your breath. And we thank you for open probation, for a time of peace, where we can come together and study your word. We thank you for all the blessings that you've given us so far, that you have led us into this truth, and that we can come closer and closer to you and get to know you. We want to ask this morning that you might open your holy word to us, that you guide us with your Holy Spirit and your holy angels, that we might understand the things that you want to teach us and want to have us know for this time in our system. We want to ask that you might be led into the truth, that you brought your latter rain upon us in the time of the latter rain. And we thank and ask all that in Jesus' name. Yesterday morning, I drew different templates, different frameworks of truth that God has been progressively opening up to us. At the beginning, it was just 9/11 Sunday law, close of prayer for our line, and now we have come to this more sophisticated understanding of how our line looks like. Just draw that again. It was early in the morning, right? So that would be right here. The morning. And then he went again in the third hour. And after that it says, in the sixth and the ninth hour he did likewise. He repeated what he had already done. So this would then be in the ninth hour, and he's combining these two waymarks. He's saying, in the sixth and the ninth hour, he did likewise. And we know that these two waymarks are not necessarily they teach the same truth. Because we understand that right here, when the angel of Revelation comes down, it's the first angel, but it's also the second. And the second goes through all this history. And right here, this whole history is marking the binding of. It's the third step. It's one symbol. And then, of course, we know he also calls the 11th hour workers. So, what this parable is teaching very nicely are these five times where a call goes forth. the last time you close on probation, there's no call for anyone because close on probation is no one can come in anymore.
This is Matthew 20. Matthew 20. Was
Matthew 20. The first verse is one. First one through 7 or 8. So we understand that this is the time for the. This is the priests. This is the Levites. This is the. Workers, and with every group, God is working the same, because God's dealing with his men is ever the same. And we're not dealing so much now with these groups, it's implied that when we study for the priests, it will be repeated for these groups. So if the priests had their first and second step here, and then their third here, the Levites, they would have their first and second from the divine forward, and then their third here. So this is also a divine law, but it's for the Levites, and this is also a divine law for the 11 old workers. And before this third step, they would have their first and second, and before this third step, they would have their first and second. So we also talked about that this first angel's message is depicted in the Bible with different characters. Who was that, for example?
Elijah.
We had Elijah, followed by Elisha. And who was Elijah at Christ's time?
John the Baptist.
It was John the Baptist who was followed by
Christ,
or Jesus. That's all right, Jesus, because the name Jesus means what?
Joshua.
And what means Joshua? Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1. Verse 21. Matthew 1:21 says, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." So his name means basically God saves. So Jesus means God saves. And it's the same as Elijah, and as you already correctly said, it's also Joshua, which was preceded by Moses. So, you remember why we can mark Joshua here? Why can we mark Joshua here in this time
period? Well, because there's a change in film. Leadership. It's not goes from Moses to Joshua. Moses dies.
Do you remember what symbol we can plug in here? That
was it the 120?
Yes, it was the 120. Because, what's the connection?
Yeah, well, Moses was 120 years old when he died.
When he's 120 years old and dies, at the end of the 120 years of Moses' life, Joshua takes over. And we derive the 120 from where?
From Ezekiel 7:9.
Ezra 7:9, right? The first day of the first month to the first day of the fifth month. It brings you here to the end of this time. Alright, so what I want to look at now is Elisha. Go to 1 Kings 19. 1 Kings chapter 19. We start in verse 15, 1 Kings 19, verse 15. It says, and the Lord said unto him, speaking to Elijah, go return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi thou shalt anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel Meholah shalt thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. And it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. Yet I have left thee 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed unto Baal, and every mouth which hath not kissed him. So he departed thence and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen before him. And he with the 12, and Elijah passed by him and cast his mantle upon him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, let me, I pray thee, kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow thee. And he said unto him, go back again, for what have I done to thee? And he returned back from him and took a yoke of oxen and slew them and boiled their flesh with the instrument of the oxen and gave unto the people, and they did eat. Then he arose and went after Elijah and ministered unto him.
That was 1 Kings 9.
19.
Oh,
19:15 through 21.
Pretty amazing that 12 yoke of oxen and then one gets sacrificed.
Amen. So we are now in this time where Elisha is supposed to take over from Elijah. And when Elijah comes to Elisha, what is Elisha doing? What has he been doing in this time period? Yeah. He was plowing. So you know somehow that he's plowing going on. And as you correctly identified, when he comes, he's plowing with 12 yoke of oxen. And before he now fully decides to follow Elijah, what is he doing with one of these 12 yoke of oxen? So one is slain. So what is marked here that from these 12, one goes and there are 11 left.
Like Jesus and his disciples.
Yeah, remember when we read Acts chapter 1? How many people were gathered in the upper room?
120.
And what was our other hint why we can mark it at the end? How long was Jesus with his disciples before he went up and they were then gathered?
40 days.
There were 40 days,
yeah.
Right? He, after the cross, so this can be marked as the cross, because after the cross we know he ascends and descends, and he breathes the Holy Spirit, a few drops of the Holy Spirit on his disciples. So you have a few drops here in the sprinkling, which is the beginning of another reign, it's Revelation 18. And then for 40 days he stays with his disciples. What happens with Jesus when directly after his baptism?
Sorry?
After his baptism, where does he go?
Oh yeah, in the wilderness.
For 40 days. So you see, this is really what we have to get into our heads, all these symbols and how they line up. So you always have to get second and third witnesses for what we're doing. So I'm just always, you know, writing back to these things.
And with the yoke of oxen, how many is in that yoke? Is there 12, is
there? No, 2.
Yeah, I think a yoke in itself has 2 oxen.
Okay, because did it say that he got a yoke and
Yeah. So, what is marked? He has 12 oxen, and one of these yokes are.
You took a yoke.
So that's 12 yokes.
12 yokes.
12 yokes.
Yeah.
Mm. So that's Judas.
What is marked there is the number 12, and one gets slain. One falls away. So when you come at Christ's time to the upper room, what do they realize? They realize there are only 11 disciples and Judas has just fallen away from the 12 disciples. So these 12 yoke of oxen, they represent the 12 disciples and one falls away. And what they do in the upper room here is they complete the number. So the number 12 marks the making the number complete. And we also can find this in the story of Elijah. So remember, it's line upon line. So let's deal first with the story of Elijah. Go to 1 Kings 18. So we're not going to read the whole thing. What is the basic story of 1 Kings 18? Elijah is told to present himself before Ahab. So he's to go to Mount Carmel. This whole story takes place at Carmel. There's an interesting thing, by the way, about Carmel, because in the scriptures you have the Mount Carmel. So sometimes when it speaks about Carmel, you have to identify, is it now the Mount Carmel? Because there's also a city called Carmel. And what does a mount stand for in the Bible?
Church.
A church. And the city is?
A state.
Yeah, it's a state. So these two symbols, they mark church and state. Carmel and it's the same thing. So this is Mount Carmel. Right, MC. This is church and state. This is this false
church.
Marriage.
Yes.
So it's telling you that this story is perfectly fulfilled here, and he is to go before a king here. Many stories where the prophet has to go before kings. Remember Daniel chapter 2. Nebuchadnezzar is sleeping, and then he wakes up because he's troubled by a dream. Right, and then Daniel has to go before the king and give an explanation. And there's a distinction made between these foolish Babylonians, these astrologers and soothsayers that don't have an answer, but Daniel, he is the true prophet. The spirit of the gods is in him. He is the wise virgin that has the oil in his lamp. That's the spirit that is in him. And this is the same story. It's a story about who is the true prophet. Is it Elijah or is it these prophets of Baal and Ashdod?
So we might be having a challenge there in that period of time in between the false priests and the wise priests. There might be a like a confrontation where they're saying one thing and they're saying another thing.
Yeah.
And but it's proven who is correct.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And it will be proven by the message they bring. And how they have now this message in them and how it has transformed them. But definitely, this is where the two classes are demonstrated. Right? This is what we know, this is the third step. The everlasting gospel is the work of Christ first producing and thereafter demonstrating two classes of worshippers based upon this three-step prophetic testing message. So this is what's happening here with Elijah and the prophets of Baal.
Is that where in the plagues, the 10 plagues, is that where that it comes to, I think, the fourth plague, and they can't repeat what Moses
says? Yeah, you can see the same principle there.
Mm-hmm.
There's also this distinction there. And what do they realize? How do they call, when they realize, oh, we can't do this plague, how do they call it? Yeah, they say it's the finger of God.
Mm-hmm.
So you can remember this, we perhaps look at this later. But this is where the finger of God comes in. Mm-hmm. And what is the finger of God?
Judgment.
Judgment? Yeah.
It's like, yeah,
it's also the story, it's the Holy Spirit, in one sense, right? The Holy Spirit, he writes his law like on the tables on our hearts. So the story here in 1 Kings 18, it takes place after there was this drought, right? There was a famine for how long? For 3.5 years, and 3.5 years is a wilderness, remember? times and half the time, the woman flees into the wilderness. So Christ, after his baptism, went for 40 days into the wilderness. And now we have the story of Elijah after 3.5 years of drought or wilderness. He comes now to this point. I just showed you how this is now bringing you to the story.
You're going to explain that a little bit more,
yeah? Yeah, I'm going to read this now.
Because there's a 40 in there.
It's just, there's a 40 in there.
Mm. Then he goes, from the strength of those three cakes, he goes 40 days to Mount Sinai. You know, when Jezebel chases him?
I think that's after that. But maybe that's a repeat in the lunch.
Mm.
Because first the showdown has to come between Elijah and the prophets, and then he's chased when he goes to this cave. So we're going to look at 1 Kings 18. If you go down to, let's start at verse 19. 1 Kings 18:19 says, "Now therefore send and gather to me all Israel unto Mount Carmel and the prophets of Baal, 450, and the prophets of the groves, 400, which eat at Jezebel's table." So Ahab sent all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together unto Mount Carmel. And Elijah came unto all the people and said, "How long held you between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him, but if Baal, then follow him." And the people answered him not a word. So he's bringing out this message of separation, right? Show now on what side you are, these two classes. And then he gives this test, right, that the Lord, he will answer by fire the one who's the true prophet. And who goes first now? Who's first to demonstrate or to do his thing? The false, right? And this is the principle that you always can see the false going first. So remember Daniel chapter 2, who goes first?
Yeah, the soothsayers.
The soothsayers, right? They go first in this three times giving their false report. You can see three times that they can't give an answer. And here, these prophets of Baal, right, doing all the dancing.
It's a bit different than Moses, though, isn't it? When Moses prays, he has to brought down the tools into the snake, and then they throw it into him, and then he's turned into the snakes, then he sees Eva.
Must be the salt.
Yeah. Maybe we'll have to look at that. So, go down to verse 25. It says, "And Elijah said unto the prophets of Baal, Choose you one bullock for yourself, and dress it first, for ye are men, and call on the name of your gods, but put no fire under. And they took the bullock which was given them, and they dressed it, and called on the name of Baal from morning even until noon, saying, O Baal, hear us. For there was no voice, nor any that answered, and they leaped upon the altar which was made. And it came to pass at noon that Elijah mocked them and said, Cry aloud, for he is a god, either he is talking, or he is pursuing, or he is on a journey, or he peradventure speaketh and must be awaked. And they cried aloud, and cut themselves after their manner with knives and lances till the blood gushed out upon them." So, in Hebrew time, noon was the 6th hour. This is, noon, what for us would be 12 o'clock.
Yeah.
It's midday. So this is midnight, but prophetically it's also midday.
So we can apply all the Bible midday, we can apply this to when.
Yeah, we're going to see that, and basically, let me just give one example for that. Keep your finger here and go to Amos chapter 8. Verse 9. Amos chapter 8, verse 9 says, "And it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord, that I will cause the sun to go down at when? At noon, and I will darken the earth in the clear day." So, at noon, he will cause that it becomes dark. So it will be also dark, midnight. Midnight and noon is the same place. And if you read on, it says, "And I will turn your peace into mourning, and all your songs into lamentation, and I will bring up sackcloth upon all loins, and baldness upon every head, and I will make it as the morning of an only son, and at the end thereof as a bitter day." So this is where our bitter experience starts. And remember, this is this trial that we have to go through. This is this bitter disappointment that we don't know exactly how it's going to look like, but it will be bitter.
Because that's the same as Elijah. He has that wonderful victory in Sinai and Carmel, but then Jezebel chases him and he wants to die. He just wants to give up.
So it won't necessarily be a disappointment like the Millerites, would it? Or could it?
I think in some ways, yes, but the principle will be the same. Remember what we say, it was only such an experience that could teach them that they should only stand on the Bible and know what the Word of God teaches and not be listening to any man. They have to stand on the scripture truth for themselves. And she said, only such an experience could teach them that very lesson. So somehow he has to give us this disappointment. This experience where we don't know what's going on for a moment, we thought we know everything, and then it looks different. We will come back to that and remember that. I just want to finish these verses here. So it says, "A bitter day," verse 11 says, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. And they shall wander from sea to sea, and from north even to the east. They shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, and shall not find it. In that day shall the fair virgins and young men faint for thirst." So we already identified that there's a famine here. But what about this? What was about this famine? There was something special. Elijah said, "It will not rain, but according to my word." So, and we read this verse in Psalms 37 where it says, "Thou shalt be satisfied in the days of famine." So this is a famine where the Lord tells you, you will be in a famine, but you won't be in a famine if you eat the manna that I'm giving you now to eat. And now you come to a famine where you can wander from east to the north and you will not find it. It marks a close of probation. So you won't find the Elijah message anymore.
Because the children of Israel were in a huge famine in that wilderness when they had that.
They were in a famine?
Yeah, like in the wilderness, that was a famine, wasn't it? Really?
Yeah, that was all. You can go to all these histories and bring them on top of each other. So in a moment we're going to go to the story where Elijah ascends, and when he's gone and he's like, what do they do? They're going to start looking for him, right? But they can't find him. They can't find the Elijah message anymore. Mm-hmm. This is like now this fan. They're thinking about the virgins. They can't find the oil. They can't buy oil anymore.
So the rain that fed him, that was the food that is received in that time. Is it? It come on living to the
world. That might be, but you have to understand this is now another story. So you will have to go down to this next story in 19 and understand how to plug it. You know, like a fragment into this history. So we're not dealing with the story at the moment, and we're not to make some.
I'm sorry, it was just that you said something from 9-11 to midnight cry about the famine instead of made me think of that.
Yes.
You said, what did you say?
There will be a famine only for the ones that don't receive this message. And why it says, hearts all around us, but we will not recognize it.
Mm.
So if you don't receive this message, I didn't inform you in the family. This is the fruit that God wants to give us. So go back to 1 Kings 18. So at noon, there is a cry. It says, cry out. And who is giving that cry? Verse 27 and 28.
The prophets of Baal.
The prophets of Baal. So you know there will be a false message. They will give their loud cry. And it comes first. And we have to stand on the truth, not to fall for this loud cry. And in verse 29 it says, and it came to pass when midday was past, and they prophesied until when? Until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice. And when was that always? It was always at the ninth hour.
3 p.m.
So it's marking this time period now from the sixth to the ninth hour. It's this binding of, remember, it's one symbol.
So it's the duality there happening.
And there was neither voice nor any to answer nor any that regarded. And Elijah said unto all the people, come near unto me, and all the people came near unto him. And he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And Elijah took how many stones? 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the son of Jacob, unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. So what's he doing? Remember, I don't know what happened in the story of Elijah. One was slain, one fell away. And like the disciples in the upper room, they make now up the number 12 again. Elijah is repairing the altar. And these 12 stones, they stand for people of God, right? The children of Israel, these 12 tribes. So the numbers being made up, this is what he's representing here, with building this altar of 12 stones. And it says in verse 32, and with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench about the altar as great as would contain 2 measures of seed. So what seed? Remember? What's a seed? It's the word of God, besides Christ and people, right? It's supposed to be 3 things. It's the word of God. By the rain or by his spirit. So you have 2 measures of his spirit. So here's a sprinkling, right? Right here. You have this 2 measures or double measure. Verse 33 says, and he put the wood in order, and cut the bullock in pieces, and laid him on the wood, and said, fill 4 barrels of water, and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. And he said, do it the second time, and they did it the second time. And he said, do it the third time, and they did it the third time. So, what do you have in here?
You have God's rain poured out 3 times.
You have this, somehow he's marking these 3 steps. So we know that under this 3rd step, all 3 are repeated. Because the 3rd is just a repetition of the everlasting gospel. It's the 1 and the 2nd combined now in him again. So this is what he's demonstrating here. And every time it says 4 barrels. So how many measures is that in total? How many barrels? 3 times 4?
12.
12. So again and again, it's pointing us to the same things, you know, to the same symbols. What's going on here?
So, what was that? About 3 times 4?
It says in verse 33, fill 4 barrels, right?
Yeah.
And then, these 4 barrels, it says do it 3 times.
Yeah.
So 3 times 4 is 12 again. So number 12 becomes a very important symbol of this binding off. We will see it over and over again. Perhaps one of the famous things that we know, it's the 144,000, but if you go to Revelation chapter 12, you have this woman that is clothed with the sun and standing on the moon, and what does she have on her head?
12 stars.
A crown with 12 stars. It's marking God's church, and specifically the church Christ. So 1 Kings 18, let's continue, verse 35. And the water ran round about the altar, and he filled the trench also with water. Verse 36. And it came to pass that at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, so we're still in this time period, remember, you already said the prophets of Baal, they were doing their thing from year to year. But it's not after that now. He has to be doing these things here, you know, the three steps before that, because it's bringing now again to the same point. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God of Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me. That this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. So, you have a double. I just write double. And what does God mark with a doubling? And we can line up all the doublings, but what does a doubling mean?
You want the simple answer?
Double. Like spiritually, what is he marking with a doubling? Go to Genesis 41. So we're not going to study this chapter, but Genesis 41 is the story of Joseph. Remember, he comes out of prison. Pharaoh had a dream. And it's Pharaoh's birthday, right? These birthday feasts and feasts in general, we already marked here at midnight cry. So Pharaoh is waking up. He's a king. It's like Nebuchadnezzar, right? He's waking up and doesn't understand the dream. Then the same thing happens. These soothsayers and these wise men of Egypt now, they come and can't give an answer of the dream that Pharaoh had. It's the same story as with Nebuchadnezzar. And then Joseph, he's Daniel, and comes in and has the answer. And Pharaoh, he had this dream two times. So it was doubled. And in Genesis 41, verse 32, Jacob explains what this means, why it was doubled. In verse 32 it says, and for that the dream was doubled unto Pharaoh twice, it is because the thing is established by God, and God will shortly bring it to pass. So when something is doubled, it's marking that something is established. What's
Genesis
going to be?
41.
Verse 32, Genesis 41, verse 32. So when something is doubled, it means by the Lord that it's established.
I guess that it comes in the same principle as on two, three.
Amen. And this is where I wanted to go next, right? Based upon the witnesses of two, everything is established. Everything shall be established. So what's going to be established here? What are we talking about? The true prophet, right? His church, the true church will be established right here for everyone to see.
And I feel really
good. It'll be shown. No, yeah.
I don't know, it just keeps coming very clear that everybody that's going to be making through this, they have to be a messenger.
What messenger?
So I just keep thinking of you people that you teach, and I'm thinking, deliver a message at the moment, it would only be you people that know how to teach this.
But
so, who's it going to be? So, that means if we want to be a part of that group, we even be included in that group, how could you?
Yeah. You see more and more why it's so important to really understand this. It's the whole test. So, one more thing. If you're familiar with the study of the seven thunders, you know the connection between the seven thunders and the seven kings. You're roughly familiar with that, I guess. Just the basic logic. In the Millerite time from 1798 to 1844, you have these seven events, right? The seven thunders are a delineation of events that transpire under the first and second angel's messages in this time. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 events. And based upon the logic that God is demonstrating the end from the beginning, you take the prophecy of the 2520, which is the seven times, and you see that from 677 to 586, you had seven kings, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which was from Manasseh to Zedekiah. And when you take the names of these kings, they illustrate the events in this history in their order. And what you can do in this history, you take out four of these kings, which is this one, this one, this one, and this one. And out of these seven, you take out four. This is the basic principle. Like, out of seven churches, you take four. Out of seven seals, you take four. Out of seven trumpets, you take four. It's a separation being made. And what is special about these four kings, they all have to do with Babylon. Babylon, 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 Babylon. This is Manasseh, Jehoiakim, Jehoiachin, and Zedekiah. He was taken to Babylon and returned, and in these three kings, there were these three sieges by Nebuchadnezzar. This is what marks them to standing out. So you can take this as a symbol, and by the way, these 1, 2, 3, 4 kings, they match up with the four mentionings of the seven times in Leviticus 26, where it speaks about seven times punishment upon God's people. And if you look at these four verses, in their order, they will match up with this king, then this king, this king, and this king. So, at the end of the world, we can mark these four kings on our line. This time it illustrates a progressive fall of God's people and the land they are living in. It's a progressive destruction. And this is what's taking place here, the progressive destruction of how the Assembly Adventist Church comes down, how the land of the United States, where they live in, is judged. But we know that, of course, it teaches also the raising up of the temple at the same time. This is the Alpha, this is the Omega, and they are the same thing at the end of the world, line upon line. So all I want you to see is that here you have Manasseh, this is Jehoiakim, and right here you have Jehoiachin, the son-in-law of the Zedekiah. And Jehoiachin, his name means establish. Because on the testimony of two, when something is doubled, the thing is established. So we were in 1 Kings.
And his name means established.
Yes, it means established. And we already marked him for a long time right here. This is where God's church will be established. And there's one interesting thing about Jehoiachin, if you study him. Right here, he was 18 years old. It says he. He became king when he was 18 years old. This is what it says in Chronicles. But if you go to the parallel story in the book of Kings, it would tell you that he was 8 years old when he became king. So, if you trust that the Bible doesn't have any mistakes and that there's a lot of contradiction, he was 8 years old right here in the time of Jehoiakim. I don't want to go into a study of that, but you can show, if this is true, that he was already anointed to be king here, but he didn't rise to the throne until here. So it tells you that what should have happened here, he should have become king here, right? He was anointed, he has anointing, right? The Spirit comes down, which is an anointing, but it's not happened here. So over and over again, you have the symbolism that what should have happened here is now prolonged until this point, and then it's going to be fulfilled.
And I guess that goes in with the history of the kings, that especially at that age, he would have had to be, what did they call it? They had the period of time when the king, you know, they didn't actually rule, but they, but the other king was still alive.
Ascension.
Yeah, it was
ascension.
That's basically an accession year. Where when because there are certain times in the year when a king would start to rule, which was according to the civil calendar in the fall. So sometimes you would have this overlap to wait for that date where two kings would reign together. So over and over again you can see how it's prolonged to the true third step. Because remember, the third angel's message was to be empowered here, but couldn't, because he has to repeat now the first and second, and then the third, for the first time in his history, to truly be empowered here when God has established the first fruits of the church triumphantly. Martyr is number 12, but after being raised up. So we were at this doubling in 1 Kings 18, where also Elijah is marking this when he says, "Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord of God, and thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice, and the wood and the stones and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench." So now you have this outpouring of the Spirit, which is fire.
Which verse was it,
Simon? This was verse 37. And 38. In 38 it says, "Then the fire of the Lord fell." So it's marking the baptism of the Holy Spirit with fire. It says, "I'm not baptizing with water, but someone comes after me that will baptize you with fire." It happens there in the body of life. Verse 39. "And when all the people saw that hair on the face of them, they said, 'The Lord is He is the God, the Lord, He is the God.'" So again, you have a double. Over and over again, when you look for these things, they stick up. And what happens right there is, you don't have to read all that, you know the story. He's now judging, right? He's slaying these false prophets. So the true prophet is slaying the false one. This is, of course, symbolic, but that's symbolic, right? You don't understand these things literally. You do it with a sword, right? What is a sword? It's a Bible, it's a message. So it's the message that the true church here brings that will close the probation for the false prophets there, for the foolish priests. Remember, we're talking about the group of the priests. It's between them, two classes among the priests.
It's interesting, last week in the church at Sabbath School, they put up a mission thing where you watch, you know, it's from the conference. And they're showing all this doom and gloom since 1844 and how that our methods haven't been working, and it's just, you know, millions of people in these cities and we're not reaching them, and that we have to change the method. We have to change our method.
Well, so they have things, to go into the cities and do a wonderful work.
They made it such doom and gloom. Like if I don't know this message, you feel hopeless.
Yeah,
but they lived off at that. We need a new method. And I thought,
but this is the test for Adventism you speak about. This would now be for the Levites.
Yeah.
And as soon as the thing is sorted out for the priests, then this message will come to them by all the Levites that are coming. right? And they have to make now kind of their decision. Mm. But what is taking place at midnight has nothing to do with what the conference plans, you know.
Yeah.
It's just for this movement, for the priests.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's where it starts with.
Interesting, I thought. Starting to say that, and I thought, I'll be interested to hear what the next part of that series is, what this method may be. As in what Ellen White says, great work to be done this week.
Yeah. There's all sorts of stuff that are taking place there. They will go into the city and will do something that looks like the wonderful work.
Mm.
Remember Matthew 7, when they say, Lord, haven't we done many wonderful works?
Mm.
And what did they do? They did miracles, healings, casting out of demons. So you can be sure that all these things will be happening.
Mm.
And they will call it a wonderful work.
Mm.
But it's not a true wonderful work.
Mm.
Lord will say, I never knew. I never knew.
Yeah.
And the Sabbath will be not.
Really, apart from me, you didn't work lawlessly.
Strong delusion.
I never knew.
And it's the Lord that is sending him upon you. God says, I will send him strong delusion. On Isaiah 66, it says, I will choose their delusions.
Mm.
It's always the Lord that is doing it. So, what Elijah is also doing, he has now to pray. And how often does he pray?
Seven
times.
Perfect.
And there's a even greater outpouring of the rain coming, right? This is what he's saying, is to pray seven times and then he can hear the sound of abundance.
Amen.
It's getting more and more.
But that 7,000 others that have around the need to lay out fire, would that be in that period? Would that be from midnight to
right here?
Yeah.
I think it's, yeah. And then who would it be marking?
The dead ones.
Yeah. Mm. Right, because Elijah is simply saying he's on his own, you know, where are all the people in advertising that do this message and then comes a confirmation, yes, there are more. There are 7,000 in the Adventist churches that when the message comes, they will be identified and they will come for. So let's go to 2 Kings. 2 Kings chapter 2. It says, starting in verse 1, and it came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry ye here, I pray thee, for the Lord hath sent me to Bethel. And Elijah said unto him, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel.
That was 2 Kings.
So,
2 Kings 2.
2 Kings 2, starting in verse 1. So, where would you map it?
That's in the transition in between. So it's got to be in the running somewhere, isn't it?
Hmm?
Yeah.
Where? 120 somewhere?
Midnight.
Yeah,
but why?
Because he's already done the ploughing, he's left the ploughing, and now he's following Elijah.
But remember, this is a new story.
Okay. Okay.
You always have to start new. You know, where is it putting you?
Okay.
You don't read these things chronologically. This is like, it's even another book. Right? You were just in 1 Kings, now you're in 2 Kings 2. You can't, you know, take these things not chronologically and say, oh, okay, it's not to be upward.
Mm-hmm.
So, verse 2. Elijah said unto Elijah, tarry ye here.
It's 9-11.
So now, oh, you get a problem, right? You think, oh, 9-11. Tarrying time, right?
But
you have to bring everything together.
Mm-hmm.
So we will see that it's midnight, but I just want you to...
I know why.
Okay?
Because Bethel means house of God.
Bethel means house of God. Okay, that's a nice idea. Let's read on and see the whole what the whole point is here, okay? So, Elijah said unto him in verse 2, as the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So what is Elijah doing with Elisha? And how is Elijah responding?
He's
testing him, right? He says, you stay here, I go to see you. Okay, what will Elijah do? And Elisha, what's he doing? I will not stay, I will come with you. I stick to you. I will stick to the Elijah message. Right? So,
that's a bit like Ruth and Naomi, isn't it?
Yeah, it's kind of the same dynamic. Go down to verse 4. And Elijah said unto him, Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to where? Jericho. And he said, as the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So what has just happened? It's just repeating the same thing. Elijah says, I'm going, tarry here. Elijah says, I will not leave thee. Go down to verse 6. And Elijah said unto him, tarry, I pray thee, here, for the Lord has sent me to Jordan. And he said, as the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And they too went on. So, what happened?
A third test.
So there are three tests. You have the number three. Now this was also the last test in this fashion. You have three tests, and all three times, what is Elijah doing?
Tarrying. Testing.
No. Elijah says, tarry here, but what is Elisha doing?
He's continuing.
Refusing to tarry.
So what would you say? Is it the everlasting gospel three-step?
Yep.
Why?
There's three tests.
There's three tests, and what are you doing during these three steps? The everlasting gospel is the work of Christ in what?
Develop.
So is Elisha here developing a character?
Yeah.
And why?
And then demonstrating.
So at the first step, how is he developing?
Because he's not tarrying. He's holding on.
Why is that developing? Is that not already demonstrating that he's?
He's using his discernment to.
He's already settled. He says, "No, I'm not going to leave you."
Yeah.
He's already demonstrating that he doesn't pass his test. And the same thing is repeated three times. There's no development illustrated. Three times he's saying, I stand firm on the Elijah message. I stand firm on the Elijah message. I stand firm on the Elijah message.
Like Jesus said to Peter.
It's three times the same thing.
Love is there.
Remember Isaiah 6? We more perfectly mark it here. When he sees the Lord in his temple, holy, holy, holy. Three times the same thing. So when you see three times the same thing, it's not a development, it's marking the repetition of the three where you're already demonstrating. Remember, this is the everlasting gospel where you're developing, but then it's repeated, it's again three steps, but now you are demonstrating your character. Daniel chapter 2. Nebuchadnezzar wakes up, Satan goes first, and these wise men of Babylon, three times they do the same thing. Three times they say, we can't give you an answer and explain your dream. No, we can't give you an answer and explain the dream. We can't give you an answer and explain the dream. Three times. They're demonstrating that they are foolish. Elisha is demonstrating that he is clinging to the Elijah message. When Christ was baptized, he went into the wilderness for 40 days. And what happens at the end of these 40 days?
Three tests.
It's not the everlasting gospel. He is demonstrating in these three tests that he doesn't fall for Satan. He has a discernment. What comes down to him? What comes down at the end of this? Who comes to him, to Christ?
Satan.
But does he come as... How does he come? How does Satan come? As an angel of light. It's a false message that is disguised as an angel of light. It will look very good. And you have to stand on the word. This is what Christ says, right? Mm-hmm. It is written. He knows what the truth is, and this is how he can identify that this is not really an angel of light from heaven. And this is the discernment that we need right here. When this false message is coming, this angel of light, you have to really know.
And we will know it.
And this is your only defense.
We know it
by line to line, by this methodology.
Amen.
This is your only defense you have then against this false message that these foolish sorcerers of Babylon, which are foolish priests, are bringing forth.
My sheep know my voice.
Yeah, yeah. So this is what Elisha, remember, he's the one that is going to be established now here, and this is demonstrating his character. So let's read on. We heard 2 Kings 2. So we just read verse 6 the third time. He's demonstrating that he will not leave the Elijah message. Verse 7. And 50 men of the sons of the prophets went and stood to view afar off, and they too stood by Jordan. And Elijah took his mantle and wrapped it together and smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither, so that they too went over on dry ground. And it came to pass, when they were gone over, that Elijah said unto Elijah, Ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken from thee. And Elijah said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. So remember the two measures of seed on the altar? He wants to know the same thing. He wants a double portion of that spirit, which is the doubling. And also, we're not going there, but I just refer you to it. He divides the waters. So, to what story is it referring you back to?
Red Sea.
The Red Sea. And what did divide these waters? What did God bring? An east wind. So somehow, Islam is like a key in this message that you will have then. By bringing this message, the waters will be divided. And we know that Islam is an indirect blessing to you. So by this message of the East, right, it's a message of the North and the East, these waters will be divided. And it says, these waters, they're more like a wall unto the left and the right side. So right there you have the two walls of marriage and Sabbath.
And then you have Joshua.
Walls? Where's the
if you read Exodus 14, Exodus 14 about the Red Sea crossing, it says that the eastern part of the waters and they were like a wall on the left and on the right.
It's also Joshua when they crossed the river to
Jericho. Yeah. So you know now where to mark these things, right? So you can go on the story of Joshua and know that when they crossed Jordan, it's speaking about this history. And when did it take place? After 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, right? This is when they do the Jordan crossing.
Yeah.
40 years wandering in the wilderness, and then... And it says he circumcised the people a second time. It says it in the verse. He circumcised the people right before they did it. He circumcised them again. Because here you have the first circumcision. It's right. I will baptize you with water. But someone will come after you who is circumcised for the second time.
Like two temple
with fire. So again and again, you have these two things that it's repeated: circumcision the second time, anointing of Jehoiachin, but he becomes king here. It's over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
As soon as you see that, so they go through the waters, and in verse 10, 2 Kings 10, it says 2 Kings 2, verse 10. And he said, Thou hast asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if thou see me when I am taken from thee, it shall be so unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. So how are you going to receive this double portion of the Spirit, this outpouring here? You have to see something, right?
Yeah.
Sorry,
verse 10. Thou hast asked a hard thing, nevertheless, if thou see me, if, it says there's a condition, if thou see what?
Me.
Elijah going to heaven, right? This is what this whole story is about.
Yeah.
It says in verse 1, Elijah, the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven. And Elisha knows, he knows this is going to take place, but he has to see it. And only then he will be benefited from that. So remember, after Christ, after his cross was resurrected, he stayed 40 days with his disciples, and then he was taken into heaven. So Elijah is a type of that. He is taken into heaven, but you have to see that. Because what do these two angels that stand there with the disciples, what do they say to the disciples when Jesus goes.
Yes, sir.
This in the same manner as you have seen him go, he will come back. So when do you think he will come back? It's right here. Because this is repeated, he ascends and descends. And in the way he ascends, he will descend. It's in our time where he will come back. So you have to see how he goes to heaven, which is marking how this church becomes the church triumphant. And by then, it's just the same point. He will come down from heaven.
I don't quite understand it.
But
I'm tired.
Let's read on. We're almost done. And then we're going to have breakfast. 11. And it came to pass, as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire, and parted them all asunder, and Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elijah saw it, and he cried, My Father, my Father. So right there you have the double, and he's seeing it. The chariot of Israel, the horsemen thereof, and he saw him no more, and he took hold of his own clothes and rent them by the bank of Jordan. And he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and smote the waters and said, Where is the Lord God of Elijah? And when he also had smitten the waters, they parted hither and thither, and Elisha went over. So we're going to stop here. We could go on, but all I want you to see, it's now the same message. Elisha takes up the Elijah message, and his church is now established. So I just want you to see these two illustrations here, or this symbol here, is not illustrating the priests and the Levites. This is the first angel's message. It's what prepares the priests, which are demonstrated by this. This is teaching a prophet being raised up. This is the message that comes, the first message, that these ones will take up and preach. And they are the priests. And the same
priests. Are they the priests? Those ones? Or those ones? They're Elijah.
This is the priest. This is the message of the priest.
Oh, okay.
It comes directly from Christ.
Okay.
They are taught this message by the first messenger, you could say. You know, okay. Raised up.
Yeah. So that's sort of like John the Baptist, so to speak.
Yeah.
He calls himself the friend of Christ.
Of the bridegroom.
And so
he is the increase, and now this whole movement of the priests, which is Elijah, which is Christ, in them, right? Because they eat now him and Joshua. They are now being raised up by this Elijah message.
So they're like an anti-type of the disciples.
Yeah.
Okay.
So by this preaching that goes forth, they are prepared, and then they become the preachers. And the same principle is now repeated for the Levites. So they will bring a message, which is a preaching that they have to see and keep and will be prepared, so that they will become the Elijahs and the Christ, having Christ in them. So this is a principle that is illustrated first for the priests and then for the Levites. Okay.
So this synopsis of 2 Kings 2, 1 to 14 is essentially that you're seeing there the transition,
yeah,
and the demonstration of that transition,
yes,
from the Elijah, from the Elijah who is the bringing of a message, and then the actual message itself being the, you know,
they become the message.
Yeah.
They become the message.
Yeah.
We are epistles written with ink on the heart. So you go and finish 2 Kings for yourself and try to understand what is illustrated there. But I really wanted to see is how we read the Bible. Remember, at the beginning, these three steps, it was just illustrating that right here you demonstrate your character three times. I cling to the Elijah message. But then it goes on to still describe this very same thing. It's now repeating and enlarging what was taken. taking place here. We're not to read these things chronologically. Even in this one chapter, if you read on, there are at least four or five fractals all illustrating what's taking place here. You know, you don't say, oh, three times Elijah demonstrated his character, and then you go to this history. No, it's repeating and enlarging. You can only define it and determine it by the symbols.
So it's a whole chapter, really, isn't it? That whole chapter name.
Yeah, and you have to find you have to write and divide the word of truth. You have to find the places here and what verse you make a cut and say, okay, now I'm going back and repeat and enlarge. This is what you have to find in every story.
Yeah, verse 15 is a visual. They see that the spirit of Elijah rests on Elisha, the sons of the prophets.
Yeah.
And when the sons of the prophets, which were of you,
You can go home and read for yourself, and we can talk about it later.
So much.
We'll see how many fractals we find.
So that was 2 Kings 2, where Elijah is at Mount Carmel, and then it's
2 Kings 2 is Elisha. You still see Elijah, but it's really about speaking about how Elijah starts.
But the terminology, the sons of the prophets, is really quite interesting. It's talking about the final generation.
Okay, you go home and read about the sons of the prophets and tell me who they are.
Okay.
But now we're going to pray.
Okay.
Dear Lord, we thank you for this morning's study, for teaching us line by line. We thank you how we can see more and more how your word becomes a little book that is teaching the same things over and over again. And still, it's an endless shore, this endless sea that we will study for eternity. Please help us to understand your word correctly, that we can stand firm on it, so when the time of testing comes, we might fully believe your word and cling to the Elijah message like Elisha did. So we want to ask for a blessing on this day and the upcoming meetings, that you will guide the people here that have come here, that have to hear these truths, open their hearts and prepare them, and be also with us now as we go to have breakfast, and help that our mind stays focused on thee. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah.